do that. And that way someone can sit there.
There's some chairs right here. You can have these chairs.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Welcome to... You want to start it? Welcome to the February PuppetNYC meeting. I'm Brian Gupta. Many of you, I know you guys. I just wanted to introduce you real quick to Andres, who's been a co-organizer of this for a long time, and James Meldrum, who has recently joined the organizing team. They're going to do the announcements.
Yes. Hi, everyone. I am Andres, one of the organizers of PuppetNYC. I want to first of all, we want to also thank our presenter today, Matthew. Thank you for that. And also, today's talk is about Puppet and Jenkins, how to use both for the automatic parsing of Puppet manifest and how to use continuous integration with Jenkins.
I just want to quickly mention the sponsors. Obviously, it wouldn't be here today without the services of Ideally. So thanks a lot, Valerie. Also, I want to mention Brando Group, who sponsored the pizzas, which is really great. If you guys want to, you know, anyone that wants to sponsor the group, when you have premiere Puppet Group, please get in contact with any of the organizers. We'll get to hook you up with that.
Briefly mention, if you guys have a talk, if you want to share your thoughts and in that talk, with the rest of the team here in that talk, just please come with us. The idea is to share knowledge from Puppet, how do we use it, and
what process. Before we go on, I've just got a few words from Ideally.
Hi.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, I don't really have anything, but yeah, just to give you like a little overview, I don't know what Ideally is. Our offices. We're like a flash sale site. So we sell clothes online in a flash sale model. So, you know, we put stuff out, only runs for 2 days, limited inventory, that kind of thing. So, but yeah, this is Emily from HR. So,
yeah. Hi, my name is Emily. I'm a recruiter here. And I just wanted to stop by and say hello and pass out my information and some interesting facts about us in the event that you may ever be looking, or perhaps you know someone who could be, or just to kind of know a little bit more about Ideally what we do here. For instance, we have 6 million members right now, and we have 2 million visitors a week. We obviously use Puppet for pure Ruby on Rails. We use a pure Ruby on Rails stack, and we work in an agile environment. And yeah, so I'm just gonna pass out this, and if you guys don't mind passing it around. Thanks. feel free to reach out if anyone ever wants to talk just about Ideally and what we do here. I love talking about the company.
Cool.
So.
Hey guys.
Hey.
I think I'm going to focus on. So I'm Matthew Barr. I'm actually the technical architect at Snap Interactive. And we're talking about Puppet, Jenkins, and CI. Snap is runs Are You Interested? .com, which is a social dating site. And it's one of the biggest social discovery platforms on the web. We have about 5 million active users, over 1 billion instructors. We primarily work with syncing to Facebook as well as a ton of data from Facebook. It's all up there. I'm a team lead for the operations group, as well as being sysadmin for over 15 years. We do DevOps, WebOps, Agile, all that nice stuff. We're not completely continuous deployment, but we're pretty darn close. And that we go live about 20 times a day, if that often. So we started using Jenkins integrally in our product and actually make sure to run full unit tests on the actual web server stack before it's deployed. We also run Selenium jobs as well as various other unit tests, PHP unit, JS unit, PHP CS, and a few other things. On the operations side, we have pretty much set up parsing as part of a pull request via GitHub, and I'll go into that all this stuff more. So, continuous integration. How many people know what continuous integration is? Okay. So, this is one of the fuzzy definitions from Wikipedia. It's the practice of frequently integrating one's code, new or changed code, with the existing code repository. Some of the essential items of that are maintaining a code repository. Who is not using a source control system right now? Thank God. Are all of you using it for your Puppet code, though? Is that a yes? Everyone is, or no? No one isn't. Okay. Let me make sure that's not mine. It's not. You also automate builds, make the build self-testing, keeping the builds fresh and fast, and everyone can see the result of the builds. So, this is what Jenkins pretty much does. So, Puppet. Does everyone know what Puppet is? Yes. Good. Right, I'm near Puppet, New York City. You should know. Jenkins. Who has heard of Jenkins? I know he's got a sticker on his laptop, so I'm fairly good guess at that. Let me rephrase that. Who hasn't? Okay. So, you can see sort of on the screen, it's pretty much an extendable open source continuous integration server. Yay. You could also say it can run cron jobs or pseudo jobs or various other things. I've actually seen some interesting concepts for running, allowing users to run jobs as root or as various pseudo jobs. You can see the console results. It does work. So it's actually not a crazy idea. Or you can go ahead and use it for, you know, what it's designed for, which is build and things like that. So this is pretty much what we're going to cover tonight. Puppet dynamic environments. Installing Jenkins, the master, installing Jenkins slaves, Mergetron, which we actually wrote in-house and is open sourced, Puppet parsing and linting, and then Puppet testing. Okay, so Puppet dynamic environments. Who's heard of dynamic environments in Puppet with Git? Okay, so probably want to go ahead and explain that a little bit. Who's heard of environments in Puppet? Okay, only about half of you. So, Puppet is able to go ahead and do environments. You can specify multiple code paths on the same server and kind of, if I pulled it up, I can show you the actual, it's really just inside your masters.puppet.com. You can specify the module path for different environments. So you can actually just specify string environment in the module path, and it will let you go ahead and use a different module path for different environments. Also different manifest paths. Those are the two major ones. Now, what's interesting about this is instead of defining manually the manifest, the actual environment, which you can do, and then manually defining the actual paths, you can actually just specify the variable of string environment. Did everyone know what I mean when I say string environment? Sorry. Money sign environment. Old habits from way too long back. If you do that, whatever the environment is will get passed from the client, or the agent, I mean, to the master, and then that will be used to go ahead and define and then look up and build the catalog. So this is great for testing. QA, dev, especially if you've got folks on your team who are not, you know, you don't want to push everything live, but you do want to do it inside a master or a production similar environment with the same code. So dynamic environments extends on that. By using the variable, you're able to go ahead and then specify that the environment is whatever environment name you pass. But they don't have to exist ahead of time. You can with Git, okay, so moving on. Now, who knows who's worked with a distributed version control system? Git, Mercurial, something like that. Bizarre thing. Who's worked with SVN? So, SVN is server-based, but has fairly reasonable branching, but it's not great. It's fairly expensive compared to, say, Git. However, if you don't know Git, just think back to SVN. It'll make some sense. So, if you go ahead and create a branch, and then either if you're on your local laptop or your local network, when you make that commit, put a commit hook in, so that the master can do a pull and an update of that actual branch to a local directory. So it'll just go out every time you make a new branch, it brings or make a commit to an existing branch. It will go ahead and actually pull it in on the master. What we do is actually use GitHub. So the paradigm is a little different. I'll get to that a little later. But basically, you've got pull requests and it's a centralized point of Git storage. Either way, we have the ability to make each branch of the repo its own environment in Puppet. So if you make a new branch in Git, say, Puppet talk test, push it up to the repo, whichever way you end up doing this, you end up with either a Git hook or a web hook from GitHub, you will end up with a environment on the master that's called PuppetNYC talk test or something like that. And on the agent, you can just specify in the command line when you run the agent, Puppet agent -t dash dash environment, and then PuppetNYC talk test. And it will actually use that branch for that agent run. Which means you can go ahead and only test something once, the thing you just committed without having to do much on the actual master. It's really helpful for a lot of these kinds of things. So, Jenkins. So most of you knew what Jenkins vaguely was. And this is how we're going to go ahead and actually do the Jenkins install. So most of this work for the Jenkins stuff relied on a module that's in the Puppet Forge. Everybody know what the Puppet Forge is? Yes. It's R. Tyler Jenkins. He's actually done a couple of sets of talks at PuppetConf over the years. This is actually a fairly heavily modified version. It's been submitted. It's actually got a pull request open in GitHub to be loaded in. All the slave code is new, and I wrote it. There's a second option for slave. There's two people who wrote some different slave code. This is the swarm code. This is all stuff I wrote, and you can actually get it from my GitHub repo. And that's up there. if you wanted to install the one that's in, it'll get merged soon, and then it'll probably be pushed to the forge a little later after that. But for now, you can get it directly from my GitHub repo. Okay, this is how you use it. So, the easiest way to do this is really right up here. You can just say include Jenkins, which is the module name, and then include Jenkins plugins 1. And that will go ahead and set up a Jenkins master, pretty much with same defaults. It's unprotected, it's open, but it will work. It doesn't do much in the configuration side, though. That's something that's a little bit beyond. It does go ahead and put in all the things you need to have a Jenkins system work. This one actually adds a plugin to the system, which helps. So that you can actually add the slaves. And this is some of the options. So the other way to do this would be to just put this code into your manifest. So class Jenkins, LTS is 1. That's long-term stable. So there's 2 versions of Jenkins. There's LTS, kind of like Ubuntu with LTS, or say RHEL versus say Fedora. So that will actually choose to use the LTS version. And if you go ahead and say repo equals 0, it will not install the repo from the public repo. So you'd have to manage the actual repo for Jenkins yourself. This is the kind of thing you probably would do if you were an enterprise environment where you didn't want to go ahead and have a new version every week. By the way, they roll a new version of Jenkins every week. It's released pretty much every week. So you may not necessarily want to use the latest stable version, quote unquote, just what that was this week. And if you want to lock down a version, build multiple systems, and make it repeatable, you may need to do that. So if you don't specify that, it will automatically go out, grab the repo from the internet, and then install directly from the repo, and like this. And then you just put in the form plugin, because you still need to do that. But it's like, slaves. Most simplistic answer. That. Very, very difficult. So sorry. I'm hoping everyone here can do that. If you run this, it will actually auto-manage a user. So it'll actually set up a new user called Jenkins Slave. It'll create the home directory, set a UID. It assumes that it'll auto-discover the master, which means it has to actually be on the same UDP network. And it'll go ahead and assume no authentication from the user. Now, this is a slightly more complicated version of that. It gives you the master URL, which is, in our case, that. I didn't actually bother abstracting it out, so you don't have to live. Lets you specify username and password in case you've got authentication turned on with the actual Jenkins master. Probably not a bad option. This lets you specify the version of the Swarm plugin. It's kind of a hack till the Jenkins folks fix some of their ways of dealing with the repos that they have in the versioning, because there's no way to get the latest version directly programmatically. You have to actually, it's a nightmare. So this specifies the number of executors. Those are the actual execute things that can actually happen, jobs that can happen on the same system at the same time. This turns on management slave, whether you plan to create the slave user or it should do it. Here you can specify the slave user name in case you want to run it as a different user versus just Jenkins slave. UID, etc. And the slave on. GitHub. Everybody know what GitHub is. Anyone need to ask someone, maybe need to explain what GitHub is. Well, the nice thing is they have pull requests and things along those lines, which allow you to go ahead and say, I'd like to go ahead and merge this code, this commit, or this series of commits with a conversation into another repo, either a branch or a repo or whatever it may be. So, that's what that does. Okay. I'm going to do the demo now. And then we'll, you know what, I'm going to hold the demo off. Let's finish up. Sure. Questions?
Yes, about the slave. What does the slave do?
The slave can execute jobs. So Jenkins basically exists to be a console for jobs, to run jobs, display their output, and then basically let users see it. So you can trigger jobs there, you can see the output of what happened, and see how things are working. So I'll show you in a few minutes, but that's pretty much what it does. If you guys have questions, please go ahead and ask them during the middle of the talk, it's fine. We don't need to hold them until the end.
Can you install this thing on the same master?
You can, but you don't necessarily need to.
Okay.
The master can run jobs on its own because it already has the ability. It doesn't need to have a slave running there. In fact, I actually do install a slave just because the environment, that way I can have a standardized environment and all the files can be owned by the right users and everything else. So we actually don't let jobs run on our master for the most part, even though it's on the same machine as the slave. We also have a bunch of slaves. Now, as to what the slaves are. Jenkins run is a Java app, and the slave is just a little Java app that runs. It's a jar with a bunch of dependencies that go ahead and do an auto discovery if you don't give it a URL, and then log in, connect, and set it up. The traditional way of doing slaves would be to use JNLP file and launch that. Download that and then have the SSH on Linux or like a service in Windows. But those have to be configured manually in the actual Jenkins master, and then it can be connected to or various other ways. There are a couple other ways of doing slaves, but most of them are not really amiable to the Puppet concept, where I have a new box, I bring it up, that runs the code, and then poof, it actually shows up in the actual system and is available for use.
Can I interject for a second? Basically, like in our case, we have, on one Jenkins system, we've got like four slaves. One runs on Windows, two run on a Mac system, and there's a third one that runs on Linux. Our server builds happen on the Linux instance. We have things that work that are being built on a Windows box, which cannot be built on any other box. They happen on the Windows slave, and there's some other things that need a UI, and we would not like to change the run levels on any of the Linux boxes that we're running on, so we run them on the Mac box, so we don't have to run headless tests for flex or things like that. So it's a simple way of farming out requests to systems different from the master. Technically, you can do the same thing on the master if you want.
So in that vein, we actually use the master as a smaller VM, but it's more accessible to the outside. The other systems are possibly even could be physical, could be other. They could also be other machines that might normally be busier, that might run gearman jobs or things like that, but they can just pick up the load and carry on and do builds while they're doing other things. We also use a Mac slave to run iOS builds. So various iOS system, so it actually does an Xcode build and then does a bunch of checks and unit test that way. And then runs a simulator, actually they're working on it now, but it does a simulator and then does some very cool things with actually running unit tests and Selenium, actually, I think, the simulator of the new build, which is kind of cool. We also have some checks that are Node.js based, so those won't really want to be on the Linux boxes that we've got configured like our prod systems, or some prod systems, something like that. So what you see here is a pull request, and this is actually the pull request. You can see our Tyler's. This is the actual pull request that is going to merge all this code that I wrote into the main module. You can see the commands and things like that. Mergertron. So my office, Snap Interactive, we had some devs write a system that goes ahead and can monitor GitHub, and look for new pull requests, download, and then basically trigger a Jenkins build with the details of that pull request. And what it does is, in our case, merges in the new code into the main client code, does a bunch of unit tests, various types, and then goes ahead and tells you whether or not it passes, and then updates the GitHub pull request with the status of the build.
With this, do you use the GitHub webhook at all?
We don't right now, but this supports the webhook and a monitor and polling and a poll. So it can use both. So it supports both of them. It just doesn't do that right now. We are not using the webhook. It supports it, though.
As of yesterday, I don't know if it's the same thing or if it's different. There's a plugin in Jenkins that actually just builds on pull requests, open pull requests. And then there's another tool on GitHub called Gently, which runs as a separate daemon, which does the same thing.
This is a daemon. This is a Node.js app written in-house. It's open source. It's not yet in NPM. It will be soon. But it basically keeps track of all the pull requests and what their status is and make sure not to redo them and things along those lines. It can be used to do pretty much anything. It just pretty much talks to Jenkins. It can actually it's pluggable, so it can actually talk to other systems than Jenkins if you want. It's fairly easy to dev. They've got Mongo support, MySQL support. I think they're working on SQLite as a backend just to store the things they've been worked on. And that is the homepage for it. If you just do a search in Google for Mergitron, you pretty much come up with this. See, it monitors pull requests, triggers Jenkins build, then new tests, etc. Yeah, there we go. And we monitor two repos, actually the ops repo, which is the Puppet code, as well as the actual unit, the website code. They do PHP unit, PHP CS, JS hint. Anything else I'm missing, Paul?
I think you got it done.
And we actually only really do Puppet parser right now on it, on our code, which leads into the Puppet testing. This is the stuff we are not currently doing right now. So there's Puppet lint at that URL. There's RSpec Puppet. Puppet lint goes ahead and just makes sure you're following the style guide from Puppet Labs. They publish one. If you don't like some of their things that they're a little too finicky or whatever, you can actually disable certain options and do various other things. But it will go ahead and complain at you precipitously if you go ahead and do something silly like, you know, put quotes, single quotes for double quotes, or double quotes for single quotes. There's RSpec Puppet, which, who knows, who's really worked with testing for Puppet? RSpec testing. Anybody? Okay. So some of you may ask why, and once you see what the RSpec code does, you basically have to define, it's pretty much test-driven development for Puppet, which basically in this case means you say, expect a package of this to be in the catalog. Well, if you've already defined what the package is, isn't that kind of exactly what you'd be doing in the actual manifest? It's pretty similar, right? So why bother? Well, I agree. I actually don't see the value in most cases, in some cases at least. But now consider you're building this module that's for release. Your systems only really have, say, Red Hat. But you're really a module that's being used by other people. And you need to make sure that on Debian, it finds the package Apache 2. And on Red Hat, it finds the package HTTP. Well, your machine's going to be fine when you use it. It won't break. But if you forgot to put in the actual test, or something happens to the module or your code, or you're using variables and you lose the variable someplace along the line, for the Debian stuff, you'll never know. It'll just up and break. And this allows you to basically define not just what you're using in your system, but also what's happening on other code paths, and make sure that you test that those code paths get exercised as well. So for larger systems or bigger code bases, or for modules that are for multiple OSs and things on those lines, it's very helpful. There's ERB parsing, which is on the Puppet site. You can just look up ERB Puppet testing. And that's actually what it is. But it'll let you make sure that your ERBs are compilable without a problem and are valid. And then there's Cucumber Puppet, which is behavioral-driven development and has been discontinued. I think earlier last year, Mostly because not much fair and complicated. There wasn't much community around it.
Also, now, the Cucumber developer quit working on Cucumber.
For a puppet?
Just Cucumber.
Yeah, that. But also the Cucumber, the puppet Cucumber guy also quit because he's no longer using puppet. So. Now, what's the future of puppet testing? So parsing is a nice start. First of all, if you're all doing local development, you should be using a commit hook, pre-commit hook, to do puppet parse. You should probably also be doing the ERB check as well. That is good to have. Now, some of our devs actually have access to commit to a branch for our code, and so that's where having the actual pull requests check is a nice second step, just to make sure they don't mess something up and mess up the syntax.
Do you have pre-commit hooks on GitHub?
No.
Sorry.
Pre-commit hook, because you're not committing to GitHub, you're pushing to GitHub.
Right.
So I have pre-commit hooks on my laptop when I'm working locally.
Oh,
remember, Git
okay.
distributed, so you typically Git commit and then Git push
right.
up to the remote.
Right.
So the commit hook is actually local, which is why that's why they have the webhooks, in fact, as post receives. They're not even so much commits, they're just post pushes, I think. SVN, I know, it was like, how do I do this? And then the answer is you don't, because the commit happens in your local machine. I didn't actually put this in there, but who's actually using Vagrant? Everyone know what Vagrant is? Yes, now it's own. Okay, so not enough people. So Vagrant is actually the ability to go ahead and run multiple VMs and control multiple VMs on your laptop at the same time. Handy for the devs. It does allow you to go ahead and build machines with Puppet locally, though. So I actually have a Vagrant build that brings up two CentOS boxes. One of them gets set up as a master with a shared local of my local copy of my Puppet repo. And so whatever's in my local machine, it's actually just a shared folder to the internal VM. And so it sets up a Puppet master. The other machine is actually brought up clean without Puppet running, so that I can run Puppet agent T on that, even in no op 11. And that way I can actually test the new code without having to even commit. So you're not even committing. You're just hitting save and then test. Save, test, save, test. Beats the heck out of going and pushing up to GitHub, pulling it down to the master, even in a branch, it's still a pain. So that's another thing. And so, going back, catalog checks are what the RSpec and what Cucumber used to do. They can help, especially for supporting multiple systems and edge cases. However, how many people have had system code that compiled cleanly, build a catalog, and then just broke on, did the catalog either didn't work or didn't compile on for the machine you're actually meaning to use, the code you're trying to do. If you haven't raised your hand, you're lying. So actually running the code on the target type system with all the target parameters is really the only way to make sure the code's actually going to work. Well, we can try to test this, but in the future, I'm hoping we can go ahead and get to, with VMs or AWS, functional unit tests against real systems that deliver your app, maybe. So we're probably going to use VMware. We're going to do this a little bit in-house. I actually ended up doing some of this and found running into trouble even for the demo. Just trying to go ahead, I ran into some interesting problems because Amazon Linux is not Red Hat Linux or CentOS, even though it's very, very close. And I hadn't tested some of the edge parameters. So, yeah, you have to try it before it works. It doesn't work until you try it. And that's pretty much it, then I'll go and go do that. So, that's Snap Interactive, and then that's my contact. My Twitter and my GitHub are both Matthew Barr, M-A-T-T-H-E-W-B-A-R-R. If you email me, or Twitter, DM me or something like that if you need anything. Most of the code's already up there. And I don't know if I can put the slides up easily, but it's okay. If you DM me, I can send you anything you need. So, demo time. Yeah.
So at what point in your development do unit tests happen?
For Puppet or for web, for the application?
Well, for example, when Merginator performs it, I guess that's one of the steps before merge happens, but I guess you also do some unit tests.
So for Puppet code, it happens fairly late, because I actually do the same checks locally on my laptop. It's just a parser. For the actual site, the dev process is something along the lines of the devs work on the code, they commit the code to their fork, they submit, they work, blah, 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 they do a pull request, they open a pull request with a bunch of commits, whatever it is. That gets run, picked up by Mergetron. That's tested with all the unit tests, which in theory they're supposed to run on their own. Okay, fine, theory is great, doesn't always happen. And that goes ahead and verifies that it will merge against the current state of the site, which might not be the actual state of the site when they actually go live with the code. But at least it's a good start. So they test it, fix any problems that come up, go on. Then they merge it in and go live. So when they go live, they actually do the actual merge into the live code base. It puts it into a staging environment, does another round of unit tests just to make sure, runs some Selenium jobs, a couple different types, mobile, web, Facebook, etc., and then goes ahead and then based on the results of those, they can then push it into the actual live site.
What's the push process like?
That was pretty much the push process. There's a console, a web page console that has just buttons that they hit that does, you know, pulls it, merges it, and then does the tests and stuff like that.
And that comes in from GitHub?
Yeah, pulls in from master repo on GitHub. And then builds it out, and then the last stage is to actually, once it's been verified and tested in the staging environment, the last stage going live is actually just an rsync.
How are you doing your pulls from GitHub? I mean, how are you authenticating against GitHub?
So, primarily we're using SSH keys right now, I think.
So you have a user in GitHub, or
yeah, there's a
special user?
I have for the organization. So first of all, we have an organization,
right,
which is how we have a private repo for our code base for the company, really. We also use a submodule that's private that isn't hosted on GitHub for things like, oh, I don't know, all the configuration passwords. But from the Puppet side, we actually use another private repo, which actually has our SSL keys in it, for example. So even though my Puppet code is actually on GitHub, my SSL keys themselves, the certs and the actual keys, are not in GitHub, which is helpful.
They're in Git, though.
They're in Git, separate submodule, internal to the network only. The Dunder leaves the network. And the script I have that actually does the update, whenever I do the dynamic site update, it'll actually just sees the update and automatically does a submodule on it for each submodule update. And if I build a new environment, a new branch, again, it just goes ahead and says, okay, retrieves the submodules as well.
So you're using submodules?
Only for two things. One of them is the swarm code, the Puppet Jenkins stuff, and because I was actively developing it. And the other is for the private submodule, for basically pretty much username, passwords, and then certs. Because really, I don't think having our enterprise EV certified, you know, EV class SSL certs, even though GitHub is supposedly your private repo and stuff like that, that's all well and good. It's a lot easier not to get out if it's never there in the first place.
Are those Git repo that you have inside? Is it just like some, you know, Git repo that's sitting out there, or are you putting it in Stash or the?
No, it's literally just a single Git repo that's a pull with, I think we've got authorized keys. It's very easy. We didn't do Garrett or any of those things. It's not really heavily managed. It's really, really light. it's not so big of a deal. There are better ways to do this. If it was a larger organization, that would make sense. There's not so many devs that it makes a difference. So we do it. Don't worry about it.
Hey, could you explain again your reasons for using GitHub versus having an internal bare repo that's authoritative?
So I came into the site, into the office, they were using GitHub already.
Yep.
I think they may have tried GitHub Enterprise. Didn't really work out all that well back then. I know there's some competitors. I think there's even an open source type GitHub Enterprise like on-site one. There's also Garrett and some of the other things along those lines. There's the one that Android uses. Is that Garrett?
Yes, Garrett.
That's Garrett, okay. There's some others as well.
So you just inherited it?
GitHub is there, it works nicely. I don't think Garrett will do the pull requests, for example.
No,
but there are other ones that now will do pull requests that pretty much built off the concept from GitHub. I'm pretty sure GitHub came up with the idea in the first place. Anyone know the history on that one? I don't. So they were kind of first in the space and really did a nice job of coming up and extending Git to really make it usable.
Yeah.
The whole concept of pull requests makes Git way nicer.
Okay. If you were using just plain vanilla Git, the whole concept of sending out a pull request is much harder to do than using something like GitHub. The other option that's becoming more practical and is seeing more users is Stash from Atlassian,
right,
where you can actually either have it on their site or a hosted instance kind of a thing, or you can actually install it like just any other Atlassian product.
So there's Stash. I think there isn't one or two others that may even be open source that are similar.
Garrett, you just push and then pull review, and that's
right.
The code that does not get merged until your peers basically approve that.
Right.
And then just...
But there, I think there is at least one other open source similar to Stash that does almost the same thing as GitHub. I'm not 100% sure.
Do you have to store sensitive information in Git? Do you use Git crypto or how do you do anything?
We don't right now, but that's because we use a private submodule that never leaves the data center, and so it's not a huge issue. Right? That's what it comes down to. And really, most of it isn't. And I guess the SSL keys are probably the most valuable thing in the whole bunch.
Private keys.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's about it.
Question regarding your Jenkins slave plugin there. When you provision a new box and it makes a connection to the master, does it automatically download the agents there?
Well, so I'll show you.
Okay.
But I can describe what it actually does. In fact, I could probably even show you the code if you'd like. It's none too elegant. But it does a wget to the Jenkins site to download the actual Swarm client, which includes all the dependencies. It's just a single jar. And then it dumps a init script into the system so that it can be easily managed via services. And so it can take the notify from the refresh if anything changes. And then it just basically does an exec. It's not using an exec, it's using the services. I had switched it from an exec to a service to make it a little more elegant, but it's templating the information that's coming over the parameters into one long command line.
Okay. So then in that case, it's completely independent of the master itself and what version you're running of the master.
The Swarm plugins have to be the same version.
Well, same. So if you update Jenkins, then your clients would just, they would
be able to. Won't be a problem.
Right.
I actually moved. So the Swarm plugin has to be the same, and so there's a plugin version that didn't specify when I showed you, but you can specify a version on that Git, on that Jenkins :: plugin module, class, I mean. You can specify a version number for that plugin if you want as an attribute, and that has to be the same 1.8. It just happens that 1.8 is the current version, and I've hard-coded it into the slave side, but it pulls the latest by default on the plugin side. But the plugins have to match. The version Jenkins doesn't really seem to much matter. It's been the same. The Swarm plugin hasn't changed for 6 or 8 months at least, I think. So it doesn't seem to be bound too hard. I imagine if they had a major change to get to Jenkins, there might have to be some updates. You just should not. Doesn't even matter. The slaves, as a general rule, are very light. They don't do much. They're really just agents that connect and get jobs and do them.
Yeah, I was just curious to know what you were doing at that initial connection to actually get.
So the initial connection with the Swarm plugin is actually far more complicated than some of the other ones, because it does an auto discovery UDP for the master, then can connect via to the URL, detects the URL, gets that, and then goes ahead and with that logs in, because you have to have permissions to do the action to add the user, to add the slave. Once it logs in, then it starts with a slave, and then connects back, and then connects to that new port. So I actually had trouble with AWS earlier because security groups have been annoying.
Oh,
so I had to actually open another port.
So then in that case, the user that you're actually specifying the slave should be able to add and have that role or set permission.
The user has to have some level of privileges on Jenkins. In the matrix model for Jenkins, there's a bunch of options.
Right.
I'm not sure which one it has to have in order to do the action it needs. I haven't actually double-checked exactly which action, what level of permission it needs, but it wasn't too bad. Also, for us, it's inside the network, so it's not a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
You can do it the other way around. It is. It's there. So, demo.
I've got one more question.
Sure.
With the topology of a network,
okay.
Where you have the network, where you have the master and the slave, did you have any instance where there's a firewall between all of that?
So, I actually had that problem today with AWS.
Okay.
If you have, in fact, I had to open 8080, which is the Jenkins URL port. Could be whatever port you're using for Jenkins, though. And then it looks, and I'm not 100% sure you can manage how well you can manage this otherwise, but it looks like it uses 53020, maybe 53025,
mm-hmm.
I think is the actual port it uses for the actual slave connection. In this case, but I don't know if that's overall or it may just be with the Swarm plugin. So I had to open up that port and then everything, and then it connected without a problem. So those two ports, and they were both TCP to do that. If you specify the master URL, then you don't do any of the auto discovery stuff. So there's no UDP stuff, the network doesn't matter because you're just getting a URL. In fact, we recently relocated our Jenkins master from one data center to another. And all I had to do was, I updated the DNS name, the IP and the DNS, and then I had to go ahead and instead of letting them auto-connect, I just have to tell it what the actual name of the master was. And basically, when I told them the new name, it went ahead and refreshed. It notified them, and that restarted the service, and poof, they just showed up. So. Nice and easy. And if you make any changes to the parameters, it'll also, again, notify them.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we'll just restart with the new command lines. And all it really does is just a simple template of the init script and writes out the variables in one long command line.
Okay.
It's not exactly the most secure thing if you're going to use a URL, you know, username to log into the Jenkins.
Mm-hmm.
So it does not abstract that username and password. The Swarm plugin doesn't allow for it right now, which is really annoying. So it'd be nice to not have to have that show up in the actual process list. But for right now, that's one of those things that if you want to avoid those kinds of things, there's other ways to do this. This was designed for a very simple, quick, scalable, very scalable system. In fact, I'll show you, I can bring up any number of slaves just by telling AWS to start. And it'll just come up, and there'll be five slaves. Well, no administrative overhead. Means you can auto-scale the workload, which is really nice. If you had to go ahead and do manual work on them, then that's not going to be so happy. The other option was using exported resources, store configs, and custom facts, and some other code that was just not pleasant, to be honest. This was much easier. So, if it isn't good enough, though, really, it's actually designed to be a simple option. It's not designed to be the only option, but it's just a nice, simple option. Okay. You guys up for a demo?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So what I'm going to demo is just bringing up, I already brought up a Puppet Master in AWS last night, I think. And then what I'm going to do is bring up a Jenkins Master, connect to it, and then I'll bring up a Jenkins slaver to it. I haven't defined any jobs, so that's not, and I don't have Mergertron running or anything else like that. So you're not going to see it doing a whole lot, but it'll come up, you'll have a UI, and then connect to it. And you'll see the slaves show up as executors. Okay. This is the hard part. Okay. I'm gonna bring, just so you guys can see. People have seen this before? It's really just the Amazon EC2 console. I'm not actually going to use the console because that would be cheating. And really, that's no fun. That is actually the code we're using. Here, these are the two machines we've got running right now. One is a Puppet Master. The other is a Jenkins Master, which is a secondary one in case there was problems with the demo. We're gonna do the, we might, if we have to, we can do the closing shift thing. So you don't see Jenkins Master or one or anything like that. So the first thing I'm gonna do is just connect into the mask, the Puppet Master. Make sure that they don't have any certs, because I was testing it earlier and really I'm building clean machines for you guys, so I have to get rid of their certs. Okay. So I launch Jenkins Master. Jenkins slave. Now I'm going to launch another Jenkins slave.
And these are VMs?
These are Amazon EC2 instances, just T1 micros. Unfortunately, I probably should have started this 5 minutes ago. Everyone familiar with EC2 and how long it can sometimes take?
Yeah.
All right.
You can see them like drop down right away.
Yeah, I can do that. That's what I'm gonna do. Okay, what do you know? There they are. Yay. Oh wait, they're initializing. So anyone have any questions? Mm-hmm. I did actually write this this launch code. It uses fog.
How do you like fog?
Interesting. Basically, goes ahead and sets it up, and then starts it, and then does a bootstrap, which allows me to go ahead and actually put in various things, and SSHs in, installs Puppet. So I'm actually installing Puppet as part of the build here. It's not actually done on the image, guys. This is just a pretty much clean Amazon Linux instance. The only thing I've done to it before this was, I think, set the Puppet master IP into etsy hosts and actually install the Puppet repo onto the system and enable, and oh, set the priority in the Puppet master on the Puppet repo so that it actually is used as opposed to being ignored by Amazon. And then also set Apple to enable. Not a huge issue. Fairly simple stuff.
Do you use any of the user data to configure?
Nope. Nothing. This was yesterday and today. I mean, some of this. I wrote all this code in the last 2 days.
You can use some user data to give some properties to instance.
I could do all those things.
The public name, host name, and all that.
Yep. I'm actually you can actually see down there. If you look here, I thought surname is equal to the name of AYI. The name I'm giving it is just actually being put into the name tag, which is what shows up right here. So if you don't, this is the name tag. This, even though it shows up in this column, it's actually just a tag in EC2. So by setting that as a tag, I'm able to go ahead and pull that name. I can then use the name in Ruby and then set the cert name to that, which means I'm not tied to using DNS names, which means that I don't have to fix them every 5 minutes and then clean them out. So just by saying Jenkins master 01, Jenkins slave 01 and 02, I know we're always going to get the same names, even though they're completely different IPs and different, have nothing to do with each other, and I don't have to worry about cleaning them out. So that's how we're doing. Now, let's see, it's finished. Hey, there we go. Okay, so we've got a master.
Is that not the good
thing? That actually is not. I didn't bother. The puppet master is elastic, just because it was driving me crazy. I didn't want to deal with it otherwise. But you don't really see that much. So, I'm going to take this one. I'm going to go up to the dashboard. Put that in. And it's going to say we can't connect. Right? Because we haven't done anything yet. So. We're going to go ahead and connect to the node. Add your type. Right, I can type on camera, especially. So I'm going to just do a no-op quickly, and I'll read you it afterwards, so you don't have to look at it this time, because the first thing it's going to do is that. Very annoying. That's the plugin sync for the standard vibe and the August providers and things like that. Okay, so let's do that again, shall we? Okay, that's pretty much what would have happened had it done it. And this time for the money. Do that. If people want me to show the code, I can actually show this. Going out, grabbing everything.
I'm trying to make sense.
Sure. This is installing the repo. Now it's getting the actual
RPM. Can you increase the font?
What?
Can you increase the font?
Sure. Is that better?
Yes.
Yeah, it doesn't help much. Sorry. I'm not sure it's going to help all that much at this point. So what it's doing right now is just actually going ahead and installing Jenkins. It's downloading it, the RPM, from the actual Jenkins repo. This So this is all I'm actually doing for the node. This is the entire node definition manifest for these systems. The top three, four lines is just the puppets, the Jenkins slaves, and then the bottom part is the Jenkins master. It's include Jenkins and then swarm, git, and save, restart, just to make life a little easier. That's really it.
Your regular expression is doing quite a bit.
Not hard, it's just normal. It's easy.
Yeah.
That way, however many slaves you add, it will just work.
So you just set this up and six up.
Yeah, let's just say it is. Sorry.
Using it in the
No, I'm not even bothering. I mean, it's just the tale of slave factory. We actually are in the process of looking at moving to a ENC. Might be looking at foreman, we'll see. But, like I said, so there. It was built that way originally.
Is there anything that you manage in Jenkins with Puppet that has to fit to an exec instead of something more built in that's notable?
So, the stuff inside Jenkins, some of it is execs, because there's a wget for the Swarm plugin and for the actual, the normal plugins are actually just wgets of a build URL that's built out. Just because that's how the module was written originally. And other things, but yeah, it's not necessarily always perfect, but there's not that many other ways to go ahead and get the actual file that you need. They're not built as RPMs from the actual upstream. There isn't a command you can issue to go ahead and trigger and install a plugin right now. There's no real API on that right yet that works nicely. So until that stuff all really works much better, it's just simpler to do it this way. Because otherwise you need to make sure you can log in and all the other things in order to use an API. This way you just, it's simple enough to just download the path, the file, and put it in the right place. So especially since you're managing the actual locations. So, now that that's done, I'll bet you that's finished. Hey, what do you know it is? Very lucky. It'll be there.
Hey!
Hey, what do you know?
Good job.
Hold on. We haven't finished quite yet. It'll be another second. Let me show you the actual money. Gotten around to automating this part, sorry. I just wrote these scripts over the last 2 days. Last week. And so they're not quite perfect.
Doing that, I just wanted to say next month, our meeting is probably going to be on a Thursday, and we're also probably going to have a Puppet Lab speaker come in to talk, and I'm going to, when that wraps up, I want to just do a quick poll, because we have a number of choices. Think about it, would you rather hear about PuppetDB, Puppet Razor, or Puppet 3.0? I'll do a quick poll. Also, we're going to the bar afterwards, if anybody's interested, so, yeah.
Sorry about that. I just realized I didn't use an Elastic IP, and because of the networking, I don't have autoconfig. This auto discovery isn't working because of the AWS firewalls, and so it didn't just auto detect. So I had to actually I just hacked and hard coded the IP earlier today. I'm sorry. Instead of using a Elastic IP.
might need a restart. It may not have notified at all, please.
Did he already allow 8080 in the file?
No, I did that already.
It's the 50.
Nope, the port changes. Okay. Port changes every time, so I didn't know that. Let's just fix that. That's the problem.
Are they going to start on a different port or something?
Can you specify the port too? What? I'm not actually sure. I haven't tried. It's the first time I've actually had network firewalls like this. Deal with? So, hold on a second. Oh, I might have when I restarted the port, maybe. Let's see what it is. No, it's because I restarted Jenkins. Okay, good. There is the mouse. I'm guessing there is a way to restart it, obviously, put the port, and obviously in the swarm side. That's gonna just be annoying. It really annoys me.
Keep restarting and then we'll come back.
No. That could take a while.
Yeah.
So while he's still working on this, I'll go ahead and do the poll. Is that okay? So we're probably going to get all three topics covered this year, but we're just talking about the next one. Who would like to hear about PuppetDB next month? About 7, 8. Puppet 3.0 changes. 1, 2. Razor. 4. Okay, so I'll ask them to do Puppet TV.
What about Collective?
I can do just saw that as well. We'll probably get a number of Puppet speakers this year.
Okay.
I'll see if they can add it to one of the other topics.
Okay.
This is the problem with doing live demos. It doesn't always work the first time, and they have firewalls that are annoying. So I will look into seeing that if you can go ahead and manage that. I don't know, the Swarm plugin might just have to be updated to go ahead and allow to go ahead and specify a port or something like that. Mm-hmm. Constant port, it doesn't allow it right now. But here you can actually see the two slaves. They currently show up as a name. You can specify that on the command line if you want, or you can do other things. I think I'm actually currently using the name, the actual host name. You can also specify labels and everything else like you would normally do in Jenkins. So you can see the label, things like that. And you can see that they have two executors, as you'd expect, because that's the default that I set in the code. And that's what's going on. Anyone have any more questions?
Is there any encryption going on between master and slave?
I don't believe so.
Is it possible to encrypt it or somehow tunnel it?
Probably. You could definitely tunnel the SSH connection. I mean, you could definitely tunnel it through an SSH connection. That would work fine. I'm not sure. I haven't really looked into it too much. Like I said, this was a quick and dirty version, primarily for inside a single data center or a VPN. So it really wasn't designed for that level of problem. There are probably ways, but if you do want to do that kind of stuff, intrude. I can quickly show the alternative to doing this. Sorry. Thank you.
choose from slave.
No, I do, but what I need to do is really add the SSH. No, we don't. We actually use I don't have to restart.
I think you can run it on Tomcat
with
SSL.
Well,
yeah, you can front it with Apache.
Yeah. No, you can definitely front this stuff with SSL without the actual the Swarm plugin stuff may not be so easy, but you could absolutely just use a standard node slave. And you can absolutely go ahead and set that up. And it initiates the connection over SSL, over SSH to the box. So you can use SSH keys, which satisfies that for the authentication to initiate the actual manager. And then I think the slave connection can come back over the SSL without much trouble. I don't know about the swarm side stuff, but that's not used, so it's okay.
How do you actually use Jenkins for the continuous integration?
So, this is how we're doing it here. This is just the ops. This is what it looks like. Sorry, if I get much bigger, it's not really readable. But here you can actually see it checking out a branch and everything else. And using the actual initiating submodules and things on those lines. Cleans up everything, then does a parse on every module, on every file, on every .pp. And finished. Success.
All right, we have one last question. Did you have a question?
I was hoping you could take us through the process of, you know, the branch and, you know, the round trip.
Probably better done offline, maybe. I'll happily tell you all about it. But that's a workflow for Git as opposed to a Jenkins kind of thing, more than anything else.
Does it go through Jenkins? Or
we use it through here, but that's only really because of our workflow, though.
Yeah.
So really, you could trigger the Jenkins build through a Git hook or through Mergetron or something else, but whatever you did is fine.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can just manually manage them. I mean, we actually have various Selenium things, Selenium designs, on demand, Selenium jobs, etc., etc.
Thank you.
Well,
so Matt, if you have any further questions, Matt will be coming to the bar, which we will figure out on the way down where it is. Yeah, is anybody else interested in going to the bar?